The current conflicts in Ukraine, Gaza, and the Red Sea have opened the West's eyes to several features of a future war. Among them, the widespread use of autonomous systems, unmanned air vehicles, UAVs, and the emergence of hypersonic missiles. By one estimate, the Ukraine is believed to be losing 10,000 UAVs each month, so these systems have become ubiquitous very quickly. UAV operators have a crucial advantage. The cost of shooting down a drone can be disproportionate, but is unavoidable because of the immense physical and moral damage such a cheap weapon can inflict. Some of them succeed by sheer weight of numbers, while others use an autonomous control system to make them smarter, and so harder to shoot down. Trusted autonomy is one of the Australian Defence Force's six key priorities following the 2023 Defence Strategic Review. But until Defence publishes its new Integrated Investment Plan and National Defence Strategy later in 2024, we won't know how the three services are internalising these lessons. However, Defence's new Australian Strategic Capabilities Accelerator, ASCA, in August 2023, issued a request for information from sovereign Australian uncrewed aerial system and trusted autonomy industry players. ASCA is looking for manufacturers of small, general purpose and reconnaissance uncrewed aerial systems that can be produced at scale. In early 2024, Defence selected 11 Australian uncrewed aerial system manufacturers for an intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance trial and demonstration program in April. However, it didn't say whether, still less when, a selected manufacturer would be named. The 11 contenders are AMSL Aero, Autonomous Technology, Basque Aerospace, Boresight, Crystal Aid Manufacture, Defentex Military Products, Edinburgh Drone Company, Geodrones Australia, iCore Autonomy, Cypec Systems and VTOL Aerospace. Ironically, a number of Australian companies have built a global reputation for their products despite making only small sales to the ADF. Melbourne-based Cypec manufactures the celebrated Corvo Precision Payload Delivery System, a remarkably cheap, disposable UAV with a 120-kilometre range and made, literally, from folded cardboard. This UAV, developed under a Defence Innovation Hub contract, has been used by the Ukrainian Armed Forces for both ISR and direct attack. The company has delivered more than 500 UAVs to Ukraine. Melbourne-based Defentex has even developed a family of UAVs that can be fired from a 40mm grenade launcher and can carry an explosive or ISR payload. They were used in Mali by the British Army in 2022 and have also been delivered to Ukraine. Also, cheap are the man-packable tactical assault drones built by Queensland company Skyborne Technologies, which can attack targets using the company's own sovereign 5-round 400mm grenade launcher. A UAV can be robotic or remotely piloted. It relies on a human to control it, to some degree, so needs a permanent wireless link for command and control and to transmit any ISR product. Or it can be autonomous. It simply gets told what to do and not to do, and is then left alone to work out for itself how to get on with it. If it needs a wireless link, it can establish one quickly, even by satellite, to transmit ISR product or to get human permission to release weapons. A UAV can operate anywhere along this spectrum, though the greater the level of autonomy, the more complex and expensive the UAV is. Ground control stations can be as simple as a smartphone or tablet, or a trailer containing pilot and payload operator positions. A man-in-the-loop, or MITL, control system usually means there is constant human control of the unmanned system so it isn't truly autonomous. Man-on-the-loop, MOTL, usually means there is human intervention only to authorize release of weapons, or when specific problems arise, meaning much higher autonomy. Unmanned systems and their payloads are getting smaller and smarter. More than a decade ago, the Australian Army acquired the 170-kilogram Textron RQ-7 Shadow 200 UAV for tactical intelligence surveillance and reconnaissance, or ISR. This is now being replaced by the in-situ RQ-21 integrator, which weighs just 61 kilograms. And satellite dishes are now compact enough to go on such a small aircraft, so eventually it will be able to operate 500 nautical miles away, using a satellite link for control and communications. The difference this will make to both ISR and targeting capability is immense. A loyal wingman-type UAV, such as Boeing's MQ-28A Ghost Bat, which the company has developed in Australia with defence and company money and is now testing in the USA, is more complex. It's a single-engine, semi-stealthy aircraft with fighter-like subsonic performance and a range of about 2,000 nautical miles, and is designed to augment crewed aircraft and conduct ISR, strike or anti-air missions independently. It uses artificial intelligence and machine learning, or AIML, to function autonomously. The Ghost Bat's autonomous vehicle management system is designed and manufactured in Melbourne by BAE Systems Australia. The company is now a global expert on such systems and on robotics and autonomous systems more generally. BAE Systems Australia has used this expertise to develop the STRIX, a VTOL UAV designed to carry an ISR or kinetic payload of 160 kilograms over 800 kilometers, and which could be in service as early as 2026. Perth-based aeronautical engineers Inov Aero designed the air vehicle itself. The relationship has been so successful that BAE Systems Australia is now a shareholder in Inov Aero. Inov Aero is also developing the one-way loitering, or OWL, munition, and the Fox Tactical VTOL UAS, and is working with Boeing subsidiary In-Situ on development of a joint integrator OWL capability based on a common ground control station and rail launcher. The integrator is launched first to find the target, and then the OWL is launched to hit it. The integrator does the post-strike recce. The ADF, principally the Australian Army, also plans to buy a small uncrewed aerial system to replace its existing AeroVironment WASP-3. This is a man-packable UAV, and so is very light, 6.5 kilograms, and considered expendable. These snapshots show four things. UAVs and payloads are getting smaller and lighter. The number of applications for UAVs is growing exponentially. Autonomy is becoming ubiquitous. And troops need training in both the use of and counters to UAVs. On the anti-UAV side, Sydney-based Drone Shield builds jammers to attack the electronic control signals, typically mobile phone or GPS signals, on which UAVs usually depend. Drone Shield is active in the Ukraine and elsewhere around the world, and not surprisingly, doesn't talk much about its client base. Canberra-based Electro-Optic Systems has two anti-UAV technologies. The Slinger uses a sensor suite to detect UAVs and an M230 30mm gun to destroy them. The Titanis counter-UAV system uses a high-energy laser to disable UAVs, from pocket size to MQ-4C Triton size, up to 4 kilometres away, and also to neutralise UAV sensors at extended ranges. And early in 2024, Defence selected its first ever laser-based counter-drone system. Melbourne-based AIM Defence's Fractal 2 Directed Energy System. The Trusted Autonomous Systems Defence Cooperative Research Centre in Brisbane has been working since 2018 on both the technology and ethics of autonomy, as well as on compliance with the laws of armed conflict and rules of engagement. It aims to solve machine cognition problems so the ADF can achieve its smart, small, many vision. Working with Skyborne Technologies and fellow Australian firm Cyborg Dynamics Engineering, along with the University of Queensland, it developed Athena AI as an autonomous detection classification capability for ground, air and maritime vehicles to support lawful targeting. Athena AI has since been selected by three undisclosed American companies supplying UAVs, unmanned ground vehicles and battlefield management systems to the Pentagon. The research center was also involved in the early stages of the MQ-28A Ghost Shark program, helping Boeing master multi-platform teaming and enabling autonomous aircraft to detect and classify ground targets. Australia is a global leader in hypersonic technology. The University of Queensland, which launched the world's first hypersonic air vehicle in 2002, leads the charge. The Defence Science and Technology Group has established a hypersonics research facility at the university's Eagle Farm facility in Queensland. Much of Australia's current work on the bilateral US-Australia Southern Cross Integrated Flight Research Experiment, or SIFIRE program, is being done there. The partners jointly developed what became the Mach 5 Plus hypersonic attack cruise missile. This will be built in the US by a Raytheon Northrop Grumman consortium. The RAAF has said the weapon will be capable of being launched by the FA-18 Super Hornet, EA-18G Growler, and F-35A Lightning II, as well as the P-8A Poseidon Maritime Surveillance Aircraft. And in January 2024, Defence confirmed it would acquire the Lockheed Martin Precision Strike Missile, a hypersonic weapon with a 500-kilometer range. Increment 4, due to enter service by 2030, will have a range of more than 1,000 kilometres. Australia's private sector is also kicking goals in hypersonics. Sydney-based Hypersonics Launch Systems 3D prints the DART AE hypersonic vehicle and its Spartan hydrogen-fueled supersonic combustion ramjet, or scramjet. The company has beaten more than 60 rivals to secure a sale to the Pentagon's Defence Innovation Unit for the latter's hypersonic and high-cadence airborne testing program. The DART AE is capable of flying non-ballistic flight patterns at speeds of Mach 5 to Mach 7 and up to 1,000 kilometres in range, or less than 7 minutes flying time. Hypersonics plans to fly it in early 2024. Autonomy and hypersonics are relatively new technologies, but proliferating wildly, and defence is in the early stages of considering how to counter them. This requires detection and tracking, positive classification as a threat, and an appropriate defeat mechanism. Australia is a world-class, in some cases a world-best, player in autonomy and hypersonics research. And Australia has wide-open spaces to test these weapons and their autonomous guidance systems. Australia typically buys missiles and aircraft from European and American suppliers. But its international research and industry relationships mean that Australian autonomy and hypersonics programs are highly valued, generating both overseas research funding and a strong export market for their technology and products. For the first time in a while, and in a high technology sector of the market, Australia's aerospace community is interacting on equal terms with its overseas counterparts.